This week on Maker Update, a window into infinity, writing your name in glass, a push stick for your kitchen, and a crabby console. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you up to date on all the cool projects that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingarner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a jam-packed show for you, so let's get started with the project of the week. If you've ever pointed a video camera at a monitor that's displaying the output of that camera, you know things get pretty weird looking really fast. Capturing that surreal weirdness is exactly why David Blair built the Light Herder. A home-built machine that's a combination of cameras, monitors, and video loopers that allow him to create haunting, fractal-like videos of video feedback. Now, if you're thinking, wait, I've heard of this one before, first of all, thanks for following the show for so long. We've talked about David's work before, but this is a more advanced iteration of what he was doing before, with improved design and better mechanics. And it's just worth checking back in on such a cool project. Instead of a construction of scrap wood, every structural member is now made from a sandwich of maple and mahogany, even these uprights for the monitor mounts. The bearings for the two rods controlling the cameras also deserve a special mention. He needs to slide them forwards and backwards. He also needs to rotate them. And most bearings do either one or the other. His solution is to use linear bearings to smooth out the sliding motion and encapsulate those in these large ball bearings for the rotation. His result is so effective that the weight of this monitor cable affects the balance. He's also using this pulley to sync the rotation of the two rods and adds a little bit of grease in case he wants to offset one from the other easily. The video system is comprised of these four screens that combine their images through semi-reflective glass at a 45-degree angle, similar to a Pepper's Ghost illusion. The upright monitors can also be shifted vertically to create image offsets, and by altering the various settings on the video converters, he's able to adjust the latency, the feedback distance. The Light Herder not only produces gorgeous imagery, but now the machine itself looks gorgeous too. I can't wait to see how this project continues to develop. We've got some more projects for you. Sometimes you see a piece of art and it just captures your imagination and you run wild with it. That's what happened to GingerofOz when he saw this digital painting of a PlayStation 1 that also looks like a crab, called the Playstacean by On Dang. This is based on the second rough of the original PlayStation with its smaller, more rounded form factor. But he also wants this to play the part, not just look it. He purchased a PlayStation 1 off of eBay to transfer the innards into his crabby new console. He needed to trim the edges of the main PCB a little bit to make it fit the curvy new body. To make the crab claws into a functional controller, he needs to route wires all the way through the arms and back to the main board. It's a gorgeous build with a fun story behind it. I also learned about Vortex, a massive volumetric display created by Ancient. This display is powered by a Raspberry Pi and these two LED matrices placed back to back. Everything is powered through this slip ring so the entire assembly, the Pi and the matrices, can spin freely. There's a circular display with a dial that's used to set the rotational speed for the volume. The look is finished by this large circular globe to house the display. There's also a ton of videos showcasing what this display looks like in action, and they look amazing. And from Project Havoc, we have this DIY Fogbuster, a tool used to deliver a mist of compressed air and coolant to your machining project to keep your cutting tools cool. It's essentially a regulator for a small amount of air pressure and cutting fluid. The irony is that, to follow his exact process, you need to do some fairly elaborate machining. And I wonder if some of these parts would do okay if they were 3D printed. It's also a gorgeous video and a fun process to follow along. We've got a good collection of tips to share with you this week, starting with how to make your own camera cables by DSLR Video Shooter. Some of this might seem a little basic if you're already used to terminating your own cables. But the real tip here is how they added this colorful mesh sleeving around each of the cables, and then buttoning everything up using shrink tubing. I also never knew that shrink tubing is rated not only with its diameter, but also a shrink factor ratio. If you have a project with some exposed cabling then you'd like to dress it up a little bit, keep this video in mind. From Zack Freedman, we have an outstanding collection of tips to make your 3D prints not look like 3D prints. He's made this cosplay prop of this antique portable alchemy case, and it's almost entirely 3D printed. The base is made from foaming lightweight PLA and then coated in velvet. This vial rack is printed in wood fill filament and covered in layers of stain and varnish until it takes on a convincing look. This wooden tray is also 3D printed, but instead of using wood filament, he's applied a layer of wooden edge banding to sell the illusion. Tons of great stuff in here. You're probably familiar with push sticks for table saws, but using them for oven racks is a new one for me. On Instructables, I found about this laser cut design for one by Makerneer. It has a hook for pulling the rack out and a notch for making it easy to push back in. There's a few holes for stripping fresh herbs, and since there was some space left over, a few cheat sheet kitchen notes. He provides all the files needed to make your own, if you like. And from Xyla Foxlin, we have a video where she's making a neon sign of her name and logo, and in that process, learning how to bend neon tubes. If you've done any work with glass before, you know it takes a lot of patience while you learn the techniques and build the muscle memory. Since neon has to be one single continuous tube, the trick is to begin with your most difficult shapes first and then work your way back out again. If you've ever wanted to see this whole process in detail, give this video a watch. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, they have a video on their Another Teaching Moment series about solar panels and photovoltaics. Turning sunlight into electricity seems pretty darn magical when you think about it, but this video helps you understand the science behind it. You also learn about the advantages and trade-offs with different solar cell construction techniques. Lots of useful info here. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. A reminder, as always, you can get more info about every single one of these projects by following the links down in the description. While you're there, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. Huge thanks, as always, to DigiKey for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.